local bands and actors, and it's a fascinating show with fascinating people that live right by you. Tune in 5 to 7 p.m. on 98.3 FM. Listen to Reality Radio. Till then, keep it real.
WRLR 98.3 FM.
This is WRLR 98.3 FM, the voice of Lake County. This is Ted Schneider on Info Explorers tonight. We've got Zach Schneider on the line, and he's going to do probably at least the first half hour, or maybe the whole hour. Zach, are you there?
I am here. Welcome, everybody. Glad to be on the show tonight.
Oh, cool, Zach. Good. Glad you're there. Again, Zach Schneider coming to us live from somewhere, an undisclosed location on Sheffield Avenue in Chicago. And this is Ted Schneider. Again, this is WRLR 98.3 FM. We are on the Info Explorer radio show coming to you live from the Round Lake Beach Metro Station. And first, as we always do, do a shout out to a few people. One, I want to say good evening to Dr. David Berger, Dr. Tracy Christensen, as well as Alex Schneider, Bella, and what's his name? Ben. I'm just teasing. Ben. And, of course, Zach's on the line. Well, Zach, you know, thanks for joining us tonight. What's going on down in the city today? Anything?
It's cold. Cold and windy.
Really? It's hot out here. I can't believe how warm it is. Balmy. Balmy in the burbs. But, no, I'm glad you could join us. You know, we're going to, you know, for those that have not listened before, WRLR is a variety unparalleled on the radio dial. If you're lucky enough to be within a certain radius of the radio station, you can get us on your AM, your FM dial at 98.3 FM. But if not, go to www.wrlr.fm, and anywhere you get an internet signal, which is pretty much anywhere in the world, you can listen to us. So it's kind of cool. Anyway, Zach, the first thing I'd like to go over is some of the things about your immune system. Now, you got that article with you, right?
I do. I'm pulling it up right now. And while it is loading, I would like to give a couple shout-outs really quickly.
Sure, go ahead.
To close friends of mine, Teresa and Dave, and then also their loving furry cat, Smokey.
Smokey?
Smokey. He's adorable.
Got it. Cool. All right, well, let's see here. We've got a couple things going on here. Let's see. All right, so long story short, we're going to talk about 15 surprising things that affect your immune system. Now, most people probably wouldn't realize some of these things affect their immune system, but again, I'm not sure she's a scientist. It's Caitlin Flynn at bestlifeonline.com, so I'm not sure her qualifications. So again, Bob and I always try to tell people, look, take things with a grain of salt. In other words, you know, we're going to give you information, some of which you can use, some you might want to discard, some you might think about, because it used to be called Something to Think About, hence the name of the show, Something to Think About, but again, Info Explorers now. Number one, excuse me, it's been a long day. Laughing. You know, they talk about laughter is the best medicine, but it has some truth to it. According to Lee S. Burke, Dr. Ph., Associate Dean of Research Affairs at Loma Linda University of Allied Health Professions. Again, these guys' business cards must be huge. Burke's been studying the impact of laughter on mental and physical health since 1988. He said, quote, laughter decreases cortisol, which then reduces stress, lowers blood pressure, increases oxygen intake, enhances the immune system, and reduces the risk of having heart disease or a stroke. Well, that's the case, Zach. You and I are pretty much bulletproof.
No, we're in the clear.
Yeah, I don't think we'll ever have heart disease or a stroke because we laugh all the time, right? I mean,
all the time.
Yeah. And for those that don't know Zach, he was the nut that fell right down from the tree and didn't move. It just like
not only the favorite child, sorry, Bree and Alec, but yeah, the orange didn't fall too far from the tree on this one, and that is for sure. Hence why I'm here.
All right, Zach. Well, how's number two? What's a surprising thing that can affect your immune system?
So number two, we're looking at optimism. So here's another reason to keep a smile on your face. It turns out that looking on the bright side doesn't just benefit your mental health. It also impacts your physical well-being. More specifically, an optimistic outlook has been linked to a healthier immune system, according to a pivotal 1998 study published in the Journal of Personality and Social Psychology.
Hmm. So, Zach, would you think you're more optimistic than pessimistic in general, or what?
Well, my thing is, when it comes to optimism, the whole half glass, half full thing is, you know, look, either way, if it's half full or half empty, your arm's going to get tired holding the thing, so who cares anyways?
Exactly. Well, no, but optimism is a good thing. In other words, you know, you have to look on the bright side. In other words, if you think about it, you go to bed every night with no promise of tomorrow, but you're optimistic, you have some kind of faith that, yeah, tomorrow's going to come. Maybe you say your prayers, maybe you do some meditation, but the point is, optimism can get you through the day. As well as denial, but that's not on this list. But number three, being too clean. It says when it comes to surprising things that can affect the immune system, Nicola Dijavorek, MD, a family doctor and advisor at Loud Cloud Health, says that many people are not aware that keeping themselves or their home too clean can actually be detrimental. You know, you talked about that before, about, you know, people always using hand sanitizer all the time. If you're constantly doing that, you know, versus just soap and water, you know, there are some germs you need to be exposed to so that your immune system can respond. In other words, overprotection leaves you very vulnerable to attacks by any microbes living outside of your immediate environment. So I guess being too clean is a bad thing. So in that case, Zach, I've seen your studio apartment. I'm sure you're not going to have any problems with your immune system based on how cleanly.
Breathe in deeply, nice and deeply.
What's number four?
Are they suggesting here that, like, after you use the restroom, not to wash your hands? Like, is that now healthier thing to do?
I think they say wash your hands after you use the bathroom, sure, especially if you're going to eat lunch or dinner or breakfast. But, I mean, they're saying, you know, people that constantly use, like, the alcohol, you know, wipe, the alcohol sanitizer, or they're using bleach at home and everything, you know.
I was going to say alcohol. Yes, please.
Yeah. Now, the alcohol wipes or the alcohol, for your hands. But anyway, I think, in other words, it's too much. It's good to wash your hands, but just soap and water is fine. I mean, there's...
Well, and then it goes into the whole thing of, is it good for babies or little or younger people that don't have a built-up immune system? Are they more prone or vulnerable to these bacterial wipes? Or, you know, like, where's that conversation at?
Well, I think on both ends of the spectrum, if you're a baby, your immune system hasn't developed, so you're definitely at risk. And if you're super old, anybody older than me, then you're definitely at risk, because at that point, I think your system's starting not to function as it should. So you have a small window, Zach, where you're protected. You know, you're past the baby, but you're getting closer to the old person. So enjoy your immune system functioning properly for the next couple of years, I think.
Let's do it. Okay. Number four, living in a rural area. This is going to be interesting. Hmm. Exposure to bacteria outside the home or the lack thereof also affects your immune system. Growing up on a farm where in person is exposed to wider ranges of bacteria is healthier for the immune system than growing up in an urban environment. Wow. Okay. That is interesting. So I should be getting out of Dodge right now.
Yeah, or maybe hang out in the woods for a while, or, you know, especially on a full moon like tonight, you know, vampires or werewolves.
Yeah, howl at the moon.
Yeah. Cured meats or canned foods. Again, surprising things that can affect your immune system. Caitlin Flynn at bestlifeonline.com. Cured meats or canned foods. And she's saying because these foods contain high levels of sodium, they impact the immune system, according to Aaron Nance, MD, in a study examining the effects of excessive salt intake on immune function. They found that a high salt diet had a potential, okay, to trigger an excessive immune response. And in that case, I guess, I mean, they say canned or cured meats. I mean, at that point, I think it depends on the quality, too. You know, if you're buying something that's, like, nasty, I can't imagine, you know, it being or cheap. You probably have an issue in terms of the quality of the food, I think, is better than what they're saying, just blanket, you know, canned goods or cured meats. Again, how about yourself, Zach? You eat a lot of canned meat?
In college, I used to eat a lot of, like, the canned chicken. Really good. Hmm. But one thing to keep an eye out when you do have canned goods is to, if you have, like, a cloth or just some material, to rinse off the top of the lid, because there can be, I don't know exactly what it was, but I remember a few years back, a man died because there was, like, fly feces, or there was, like, some sort of feces that, like resonated inside, like between the can and the lid, and it was super contagious and super, like, deadly. And so what they suggest is to rinse, like, pour some water over cans and, like, just, like, scoop around the sides once or twice to potentially block anything that is poisonous or not healthy for you.
Maybe you should just boil the cans first.
Yeah, there you go. especially if it's soup, just eat it as is.
Yeah, exactly. Just boil it and, you know, cut a hole in the side or something. Too much exercise. Now, but Zach, do you know anybody that does too much exercise? No, but I know.
Not like I'm talking to him right now.
No, exactly. But it's no surprise that not getting enough exercise can weaken your immune system. But Mitchell, again, that MD, was talking about over-exercising can also be harmful. Too much exercise increases IL-6, which is the shortcut, which is what, interleukin, and depresses immune system function. Oh, that makes sense. I think, you know, there's a balance. Again, you know, how about yourself, Zach? You think you achieve a balance every day between exercise and not exercise?
I'd like to think I have a balance, but then when I look in the mirror, I'm so that's not a balance.
Well, unless you can see your heart and all your body functions and get some blood work, it's really hard to tell what the outside is. And don't be fooled, because I've found out from personal experience, you know, the outside can look a certain way, but really it's the inside that what's going on. So have some blood work done, have your numbers checked by a qualified doctor to get a better idea of how healthy you are.
As long as you're happy.
Well, that's true, but I mean, again, you look at people that run through the desert, you know, for 50 miles. That's got to affect your system. And what's the benefit of that, really, in terms of excessive stress on the body? So I would think there, again, it's a balance. You know, you're not going to drink in moderation, exercise in moderation, you know, get your sleep, and balance the foods out. Balance the foods out you eat.
Well, and speaking for, I don't know if it's just it's a us thing, but at the same time, you have to remember is once you get involved with something and that it becomes an obsession. So then you lose sight of what is, you know, moderation, because you want to run that extra quarter mile or you want to save that extra 300 calories. You know, you become engulfed in this lifestyle that you're not thinking, maybe this isn't healthy for me. It's just naturally the body craving faster, stronger, less, you know, so it becomes also that a lifestyle that you get, you know, thrown into, and you don't realize that you need to take a step back and, you know, put some extra calories in you, or maybe, you know, not run 7 days a week, or, you know, self-care is the best care.
Yeah, and again, that goes that goes back to balance, Zach. You have to definitely get a balance in terms of what you're doing, regarding the not too much, not enough. It's kind of like the three little bears. You know, this one's too soft, this is too hard, this one's just right. How about number seven, Zach?
Loss and grief. Losing a loved one is a devastating experience, and long-term grief can impact your immune system, according to a 2012 study published in Dialogues in Clinical Neuroscience. Researchers found that an unresolving grief response may be a risk factor, for altered immune response, but this effect is not immediate. Participants characterized as having a harm avoidant temperament and long-lasting dysphoric mood 6 months after the unexpected loss of a loved one had a more reduced immune system response than participants who exhibited lower grief levels.
Well, that makes sense. I think about you're depressed. You might have a situation where you're not feeling as good. You know, you're not optimistic anymore. You're not maybe happy. I can imagine loss and grief definitely weigh in on you. And I wouldn't say loss and grief. I would say issues like, you know, significant emotional events, loss of a job, maybe a health issue, divorce, you know, anything that'd be significant and emotional, I would think would impact your immune system in terms of how you react, as well as how you go day to day.
Yeah, definitely anything that'd be emotionally traumatic, I feel like would definitely, well, because you have to then, now you're not eating. Now, you know, again, the optimism right there, you're not being optimistic. So naturally, you know, you're a byproduct of what you believe. So if you're, you know, down in the dumps and consistently down in the dumps, and then you never know, you have work, maybe you don't like a boss, or maybe you got assigned a task that you don't know how to do, and you're confused, and then you have that on top of it. So now you just have a bunch of things that now all you see is negativity, and there's not that light at the end of the tunnel. So everything can just really, and the body picks up on that, obviously. So that would be something that could definitely affect it as well.
Exactly. Well, number eight, loneliness. There was a 2015 study published in Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences found that perceived social isolation is linked to immune system changes. Again, I would think if you're lonely, you're depressed, I would think, you know, you might have thoughts of ending your life, whatever. I can't imagine that helping your immune system if you're emotionally and then, you know, then, of course, triggering a physical response you know, based on that emotional response.
Well, talk about loneliness. I've been single for about, I think, 10 years, so I get it.
Well, Zach,
but don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. I laugh about it once I'm done crying about it.
Okay. And that's good because, you know, you see the optimistic viewpoint that you're healthy. You've got a great life by yourself. And we'll talk off the air about some of your shortcomings and what happens with loneliness, but I want to do that on the air with everybody listening.
I'll be looking forward to that phone call.
Number nine, Zach.
All right. Number nine, we are at chronic stress. So our stress hormones, evolutionarily, were only meant to be activated in a time of serious threat, often referred to as a flight or fight or flight response, says Tanya Elliott, MD and associate attending at NYU Langone Health. But chronic stress means lower levels of these hormones are constantly circulating in your blood. Elliot explains that this stimulates chronic inflammation of a host of organs, which in turn fatigues our immune system. Wow, that one threw me for a loop.
All right, well, Zach, let's take a quick second here and do a station break.
Let's do it.
You're listening to 98.3 FM, WRLR, LP, Round Lake, Illinois.
Well, folks, if you just join us, this is Info Explorers with Ted Schneider and Bob Slipke every Tuesday from 7 to 9. Tonight, it's Ted Schneider with special guest, Zach Schneider, coming to us via our phone system.
Hello, hello.
Yeah, I'm still here, Zach. Can you hear me?
I can hear you loud and clear.
All right, good. Well, we're going over. The first article was 15 Surprising Things That Can Affect Your Immune System, bestlifeonline.com by Caitlin Flynn. And again, these are just suggestions, but you know, some of this stuff is worth thinking about. Again, we're not doctors, we're not nurses, we're not pediatric pathologists, but you know what? We're just giving you some information that you can hopefully use and think about, and then go from there. But for the on a very serious note, the doctors and nurses out there, yeah, my hat's off to you. I've had firsthand experience lately watching them in action at a hospital where my mom was recovering from a hip surgery. And she's actually in rehab tonight, be there tonight for the next several weeks. But also, again, exposure and listening and learning a lot, again, from Dr. David Berger, as well as Dr. Tracy Christensen. Very, very interesting conversations we've had over the last several months, just day to day. I mean, they're very, very intelligent individuals, and I appreciate their experience, their education, as well being really a wealth of knowledge. Anyway. So back to the surprising things that can affect your immune system. Number 10, Zach, why don't you take that one? You still there, Zach?
It's going to be a good read.
I'm sorry?
Can you still hear me?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, number 10, bottling up emotions. So this is right up my alley every day. According to a 2018 study published by Brian, Behavior and Immunity, negative moods can affect immune response functions and increase the risk of
exasperated inflammation.
Exactly. That one got me. Inflammation. So that same year, researchers at Penn State found that teenagers who suppressed negative emotions were more likely to produce more pro-inflammatory cytokines, molecules that signal to other cells that there is a threat present and that the body's immune system needs to kick into gear. A high level of cytokines, whatever that is, it sounds important, suggests that the immune system isn't functioning the way it should be.
Right. So I guess bottling up emotions, at some point you need to let things go. Go to the axe throwing contest or exercise or whatever, you know, just meditate. I think at some point, it goes back to the stress thing. If you bottle things up, it kind of builds and builds and builds, almost like a pressure cooker.
But also you have to remember, too, well, at least speaking for personal experiences, bottling things up is way easier than talking about them.
That's true.
And so that's why I definitely come across as a bottler-upper, if you will. One, mainly because I don't feel like I have somebody significantly close with girlfriend, wife, you know, things like that, that I would feel open and comfortable to talk about the deeper demons that are inside. So it's easier just to push it off and say, nah, I'm fine. I don't need it, you know. And then who knows what happens 10 years later, but.
Okay, that's a good point, Zach. So I would definitely, you know, see if you can confide in somebody. Again, I'm not a professional, but I think definitely having someone to talk to is a good thing. But anyway, and I think we had some good conversations over the almost 28 years.
Yeah, 28 years, 3 days ago.
So happy birthday again for those that missed Zach's birthday. It was December 6th.
Thank you.
He's still taking cards, cash, and other gifts.
I was going to say, for personal request, please hit me up and I will give you my address.
Yeah, or his Venmo.
Or Venmo. I accept Venmo. It's 2019. I do accept it.
That's good, Zach. Anyway, but I think it's definitely important on a serious note to have someone to talk to. You want to celebrate the highs as well as, talk about the lows each day. Because, that's what life's about. Some highs, some lows, and some place in between.
Hit him with the high, hit him with the low.
And Zach is not a singer by profession, and you wouldn't know that. anyway, we're talking about 15 surprising things that can affect your immune system. And let's see here. Alcohol use. Well, again, drinking has a negative effect on the immune system, especially when it's in excess. Well, no kidding. Alcohol use may weaken the immune system by changing the balance of normal microorganisms that live in a healthy body. Leading to increased inflammation, says Dr. Let's see here, Shreg Shah, co-founder of Push Health. And that makes sense, that alcohol use can impair different cells in the immune system, including like the liver. I mean, think about at a certain point, the liver's not going to function as it should, or it'll slowly die off, based on that exposure and the, I would think, the amount of alcohol as well as the type of alcohol. So I definitely, once again, moderation. If you're going to drink, that's fine. But I wouldn't, I'll put it this way. There were a lady that I was talking to at work the other day, had a number of people at her house for a party. 12 people there, and they went through 22 bottles of wine.
Jeez.
Yeah. And
got a bunch of winos.
Well, I mean, I'm not going to judge, but that seems like a lot of wine for 12 people. But, who am I to judge? But either way, moderation. Number 12 is
that. Or you look at it the other way, and you just drink so much that you don't feel anything, so then you're fine.
True, but at some point, it's got to be.
That's not the way of going about it.
Yeah. That's got to damage your system at some point. So I would advise against that if I was a doctor.
So this next one, this is actually interesting because mainly only because with the whole new vaping and the different effects of what a normal cigarette would do to you or what vaping would do, because obviously vaping is different chemicals, different smoke, so it has to be, and the body's not used to it, so not saying that you're naturally used to nicotine, but the common effects of cigarettes are normal, where there's really, I mean, people are coming out dying of smoking, but no one knows the long-term effects of what it's like for smoking vape for 10, 15, 20 years. So this is actually interesting, but what affects the immune system? Number 12 is nicotine use. So it's no secret that nicotine use can wreak havoc on your respiratory system. It found that it can also harm your immune system. According to the study from ACTA Pharmacological, the study, nicotine use affects both branches of the immune system and produces an altered immune response that is characterized by a decrease in inflammation, a decreased antibody response, and a reduction in T cell receptors, mediated signaling.
Yeah, bottom line is I wouldn't vape, I wouldn't smoke, I'd stay away from cigars. You know what? I wouldn't put any smoke in my body, if I put it that way.
Well, the crazy thing is which kind of, oddly, I guess turning 28, now things start bothering me, but it's just vaping appeals to such young children, and it's like they're at such a young age where it's like putting mustard and Kool-Aid, their body's still molding, their brains are still molding, everything like that. So it's just, I don't feel like it's appealing to children, and it's appealing to a market that shouldn't be appealed to. And I just think it's bad things are going to come from this.
Yeah, I agree. And I think at some level, you talk about the age of these kids and their development stage, as well as, everything's not fully formed. You remember thinking about, this is a brain of a teenager and it's like the size of a walnut. But the point is, I think their bodies are still growing. So at a certain age, if they're damaging things or affecting things in a negative way through alcohol, through drugs, through nicotine, I can't imagine it having a short-term effect that I would think would be a long-term effect, especially at a young age. And speaking of age, number 13 is age. Age definitely has a bearing on the immune system, which I mentioned earlier. I read ahead. Very young infants are more prone to infections because their antibodies haven't fully developed, and the elderly have decreased immunity because their antibodies have waned. Well, that's true. That makes sense. It's, you know, at some point, things aren't fully developed, and at some point at the end of the spectrum, when you get, you know, older, much older, things are starting to, you know, not work like they should. So I think age, there's a range between, let's see, I don't know, post-puberty and, say, 85, that, you know, things working as they should, as long as you're not damaging them through alcohol use, through exercising too much, or whatever things we just talked about. Number 14, Zach, in terms of things that can affect your immune system.
All right, so this is a good one. So it's medication. I'm assuming it's just over-the-counter, but you never know. It is almost 2020, and Illinois is about to legalize something, so you never know what type of medication we're talking here. But for this, we have certain medications can negatively affect your immune system. Mitchell notes that acid-blocking heartburn medications like Prilosec decrease stomach acid and allow yeast and bacteria to overgrow, which in turn lowers immunity.
Hmm. Yeah, and that makes sense. I think they're talking about any kind of medications. You think at some point, you know, the body's, you're taking something for A, but it might have an impact, and, you know, possible side effects include blah, 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 blah.
Yeah, loss of hearing, loss of seeing, loss of everything.
Yeah, bleeding from here, bleeding from there. So I guess the point is, like anything else, you know, steroids, you know, decrease the inflammation by reducing the chemical activity of the body's immune system. So, well, okay. Medications and different prescription drugs in particular are out there to help you. But I think at some point, you know, if you're on too much or you abuse anything, a particular medication, I can't imagine having a positive effect on your body, especially the immune system. And lastly, oral hygiene. Daniel Nyson, a dentist in Beverly Hills, says there's a significant connection between oral health and your immune system. Risk factors such as periodontal disease, decay, and oral infections elicit the white blood cells, which are the defense system to our immune system and, you know, are activated to fight these oral diseases. If oral infections aren't treated, your immune system may become compromised and weaken over time. And that makes sense. You know, you got to floss, pick, maybe use your water pick, rinse, and I would think brush and, you know, keep your oral health up. Any comments on that, Zach?
I do not know. I'm a regular. So actually, one thing that I have gotten big into is it's like the floss sticks. I love mm-hmm. those things. Way easier than the traditional string and the two fingers and awkwardly like jamming one finger in the back of your mouth and awkwardly doing it. So I'm a huge fan of the floss sticks for sure.
Like the little violin things.
Yeah, and then, like, the other side, they have, like, the dangerously sharp plastic point that I'm always afraid to use. I'm just like, I'm going to just bleed like no other doing this thing. So I don't use that, and I haven't perfected the tool that well yet. But the regular string side, all about it.
Well, I'll be careful on that. I'd say I would definitely be careful on that. All right, well, hey, this is WRLR 98.3 FM. You're talking to Ted Schneider and Zach Schneider coming to you live again on the Info Explorers radio show. Broadcasting originally as well as essentially from the Round Lake Beach Metro Station. And Zach, I thank you for being on tonight. I really appreciate your input as well as being there. The second thing we want to talk about is 15 tips for surviving the holidays. And what we'll do, let's go to the Psychology Today one first, Zach. It's on the second page by Linda Walter. PsychologyToday.com, 10 tips for surviving the holidays. You see that one?
Let's do it. I'm there.
Okay. Well, one, keep your regular routine. A change in routine can lead to additional stress. Try to exercise at your usual time. Go to meetings that you normally go to and stick to a normal as diet as possible. And that makes sense. You know, a lot of times the holiday season brings a lot of guests out of town. You eat differently. You've got parties for work, parties from friends. And the problem is your system and your schedule gets whacked out. You find that for yourself, Zach, or no?
I do. I definitely do. But I'm kind of confused about this. So you're telling me that I'm going to have to go to all these family events and then have to drive here and go there and then be here and have to dress up on the weekend, which I don't like to do, and then have all this food put in front of me and says keep my normal routine?
Well, stick to as normal a diet as you can.
Yeah, that's not happening to me.
Well, maybe try a little bit of everything.
It's a large spread, so we might be having a lot of little things. I still might need 2 plates.
Well, I think they're saying in general your regular routine. I mean, it's the holidays. People tend to drink a little more, eat a little more between, say, Thanksgiving and New Year's. Again, parties, you know, the holiday spirit, experimenting with different things or being exposed to different things you maybe don't typically eat. The point is, you definitely want to make sure you keep a regular routine, though, in terms of sleep. You know, getting up. It's almost like being sleeping at a hotel. You know, it's really hard. You go out of town for business for a week to keep your normal routine. You get up at different times. Maybe you have different schedules for exercise. So I guess the point is you got days off. Perhaps maybe you're using like the last year of vacation time by the end of the year. You want to keep as much of a normal routine as possible. Okay.
Well, for going on the point of PTO, if that doesn't roll over, oh, yeah. I'm taking any day off to potentially use all of it. I love work, but I'm getting my PTO usage.
Exactly. For people who don't know, that's pretend time off, PTO, for us that work all the time. Well, number two, think moderation. Again, this is according to Linda Walter at psychologytoday.com. 10 tips for surviving the holiday. Again, moderation is that. We just talked about that, right? You don't want to be drinking too much or overindulging in too much food to the point of where maybe you get sick. You're bursting at the seams, your intestines explode, whatever. You get the point.
I think the biggest thing with moderation is it's not so much at the family functions or at the company party. That moderation is just naturally going to be there because it's your friends and it's your family and it's your work. You don't want any career limiting moves.
True.
But the things that moderation get me at, now the moderation ones are at Friendsgivings.
Okay.
Now those are dangerous because you're meeting up with old college buddies, high school friends, your athlete friends, you name it, and you're meeting up with all the people that aren't going to have or don't feel the pressure for moderation. So those can get a little crazy and out of hand because you're being reunited with your good friends from back in the day or good people that you met. And so one too many drinks, not saying it's happened to me, can definitely happen at Friendsgivings.
That's true. But I would definitely be a leader among your friends and tell them, look, just say no. Okay? I mean, I would definitely.
We have different friends.
Yeah. I mean, Zach, if you want someone to come along to your friend celebrations, I'll say, hey, buddy, come here. Let me slap you around a little bit. You know, I mean, if you need it. I mean, that'll help you if you want me to, like, keep things under control. Like, all right, put that bottle away. Put the keg away. Hey, you.
Your number will not be considered in that invitation list, to say the least.
All right. Well, I just thought if I could help, you know, I'm there for you. Well, let's take a quick station ID. 1 second.
You're listening to 98.3 FM, WRLR LP, Round Lake, Illinois.
That's right. And this is Zach Schneider and Ted Schneider on. And, Zach, that's a little ID here, but let's take a real break. How's that sound? You ready for a break?
I'm ready for a break.
All right. Give me a second here.
WRLR, 98.3 FM.
WRLR is community radio.
I feel much more informed with what's happening today.
When we say community, we really mean it.
It's not like corporate, it's just a good station, you know?
We don't belong to some large corporation that makes a profit from this station.
Because I like the diversity.
And listeners won't be forced to listen to large blocks of advertising. Operations at community radio stations are made possible through grants and underwriting from companies within this area of operation. And donations, funds, and equipment, services, and time from area residents who volunteer their time to get involved.
It's as if it's my next-door neighbor talking to me, only he's on the radio instead of next door to me.
Real people just like you.
I like them. They tell it like it is.
Local focus, local news, local music, of the local people, and by the local people.
It's different than the rest of the stuff I hear.
I love the show. I listen every day.
WRLR.
I can take care of myself. I can make a peanut butter sandwich. I can brush my teeth, and I can give myself a bath. I can walk home alone from school. I can pick dinner from the trash behind the deli. I can watch the baby for the whole weekend. I can keep a baseball bat by my bed just in case there's trouble. Don't worry about me. I can take care of myself.
If you're in jail, who'll be there to take care of your family? Something to think about before committing a gun crime. Gun crimes hit home. This message brought to you by Project Safe Neighborhoods and the Ad Council.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, this is WRLR 98.3 FM, the voice of Lake County. You have Ted Schneider and Bob Slipke every Tuesday from 7 to 9. But tonight, just Ted Schneider with his special guest, Zach Schneider.
Zach Schneider.
Yeah, Zach, hey. I'm glad you're still
Hello,
there.
Home.
Man, you didn't fall asleep or, you know, take off or...
Again, I almost did.
Okay, well, Zach's coming to us live from Chicago down near Wrigley Field.
Just two blocks north, live.
All right, cool. Well, we were talking about 10 tips for surviving the holidays. We just finished Thanksgiving, and we've got Christmas Eve, Christmas, we've got New Year's, all these different parties with friends and family as well as work. We talked about keeping a regular routine. We talked about thinking of moderation. And number three, Zach, what's that about? Again, this is Psychology Today, Linda Walter, number three.
Yeah, so this is interesting. When I see this, I think of like a movie, or I think of, you know, relating to something that's, you know, bigger than what it actually is. But it's so number three is be realistic and try not to expect the ideal holiday. And so many of us have an idealized version of what the holidays should be like and are very disappointed when they don't live up to those expectations. Try to be realistic. Remember, nobody has a perfect holiday or a perfect family, which I don't know about that because I think our family is it's pretty perfect.
Well, I'm not sure about that either, Zach, but hey, give it a shot.
Well, maybe for me. I'm sorry, what did you say?
I'm sorry?
What did you say after? I didn't hear
you. Oh, I said I'm not sure anything's perfect, but,
Well, I think I'm perfect, so maybe that's why I'm just getting confused.
Yeah, speaking from his own perspective. All right, we'll continue on. Number four talks about stay connected. You know, make sure... Leave time to spend with friends and family when you who you value. And that's true about staying connected. You want to make sure, like anything else, we talked before about being lonely. We talked before about maybe not having the the closeness of people around you. Find your real friends, you know, not just friends that click like or that you have found on social media, but friends you can actually spend some time with. You go to breakfast with, maybe you hang out and do something like a movie. But again, you want to stay connected. You want to stay in touch with friends and family, and those people that you really cherish.
And nowadays, too, just to touch on that, especially with social media, I personally don't know what it's like to stay connected with friends prior to the internet, but nowadays, everyone knows what everyone's doing, and especially if we all have that one friend that posts every hour where they're at, who they're with, what they're doing. You know, so with the internet, it's almost like you're like unconsciously knowing everything about people without knowing it.
Okay, that makes sense. And again, that's not really what they're talking about. I think they're talking about more, face-to-face connections, call some friends up, maybe talk to your loved ones. Again, you know, spend time with those people that are close to you that you appreciate the most.
Oh, you know, I was totally agree exactly. But I'm saying it's nowadays it's harder to do that because since you have such access to everyone's personal lives or to what they're doing, it's like, well, why call them? I know that they're here. Or why do so? It's even a harder push because that curiosity or that wondering aspect of what somebody is doing, where you're like, oh, they're at the baseball game. Like, I don't need to call them or I don't need to. So the true friends, the real friends, are the ones that you're still seeing what they're doing online, this and that, and then also still making sure you're doing the proper steps to giving them a call, setting up a time for a coffee or meeting up for dinner, you know, things like that, instead of just resorting to social media as a form of connection.
I agree. Very good points. Number five, again, according to Psychology Today, how to survive the holidays. Throw guilt out the window. Try not to be unreasonable and put unreasonable amount of pressure on yourself to be happy, to rejoice, or even to enjoy the holidays. Likewise, try not to overanalyze your interactions with others, which is hard to do. Sometimes I leave a party and go, I really shouldn't have said that. Yeah, I could have just left, but I had to say one more thing and that was funny.
Had to get that last zinger out.
I shouldn't have done that. But, you know, in other words, give yourself a break this holiday season. It's true. In other words, you know, forgive yourself, forgive others, but at the same point, you know, don't put too much pressure on yourself. Laugh at yourself, laugh at others, laugh at the world. Don't laugh at the cop when he pulls you over. But the point is, you know, a lot of times we have a lot of guilt, and this holiday season, throw it out the window no matter what you do. Number six.
Number six, don't be alone if you don't want to be. If you anticipate spending the holidays alone, try to volunteer somewhere, like in a soup kitchen with children in group homes or the elderly in various facilities. Mm. People will so appreciate you that you may feel better about yourself, but more importantly, you'll have company. And that's what I actually want to touch upon this, is that this is very true. So I remember back in college, there was a couple Thanksgivings that I would have. And I went to college in St. Louis, and it was about a 6-hour commute. And so back up to Illinois, Chicagoland. And so instead of doing that commute, I would just work at the local restaurant that I did and just do deliveries. And I would work doubles. And, you know, sure, the extra $110 in my pocket was obviously amazing. But when all my friends came back from the holidays, and they're like, oh, you know, this, family, blah, blah, and I was just kind of like, you know, that extra $110 really wasn't worth it. So I quickly made the change, and I started to go to my grandparents' house. They lived in Independence Grove, Missouri, which was about like a 3-hour drive from where I was at, and I would celebrate holidays and things like that with them, and that was much more rewarding than the extra couple bucks in my pocket.
Okay. Well, that's true, though. Again, I guess the whole message is if you don't want to be alone, make an effort not to be alone, especially if you think about depression, you know, and loneliness, as we talked about earlier. Again, focus on today, not yesterday. According to Psychology Today, focus on today. There's something about being with family and old friends that makes us become who we are and not who we were. Again, you want to basically focus on today. A lot of times we get nostalgic around the holidays, and that's great, you know, old traditions and memories. But a lot of times, you know, it's almost like you'll miss the present if you're focused too much on the past. So definitely be present in general. You know, put your phone down, interact with those around you. But again, focus on today, not yesterday. Number 8, Zach.
This is a tough one. Man, I was looking at this just now, and man, okay. So number 8, just say no. It's okay to say no when you are asked to do more than you can. It's fine to say no to some invitations, and fine to say no to those asking for favors. Remember, this is your holiday too. And now, I'm a sucker for this. I feel this. I can be tired, not wanting to go out, set all day. I'm sitting at work at my desk, and I'm just like, man, I can't wait to go home. I can't wait to kick the shoes off. Maybe watch some TV, make some food. I don't know. And this, I can be 5:00, and I can get a text message, and somebody. I know this isn't the holidays, but this is just in general. And somebody could text me, and I'm like, yep, I'm in. Like, FOMO, the fear of missing out, is 100% a disease of mine, and it's so hard for me to say no. That is when I'm going out or in the, you know, plans and whatnot. I definitely have major FOMO.
No, that's true. And I think it says just say no in terms of sometimes you overcommit. And I can be overcommit to volunteering, overcommit to parties, overcommit in a lot of things, in relationships perhaps, as well as at work. There's a time and place to say no.
Or what it is that it's the opposite, where I get an invitation 2 weeks, you know, 2 weeks down the line. I'm like, oh, my God, yeah, that'll be so much fun. And then 2 weeks come, I'm just like, ugh, I don't want to go.
It's snowing. It's cold. I'm tired.
Yeah, all Susie's, the excuses come out.
Susie's going to be there, and I hate Susie. No, but yeah, I get it, you know, and you get optimistic because you think, oh, I'm popular, and, ooh, I got invited to all these parties. And the day after, like, the reality is I'm tired. The reality is I don't want to go. But, again, the point is there's a time.
It sounded better 2 weeks ago than it does right now.
Exactly, as I'm laying on the couch like a sloth. Anyway, just say no. Number 9, ask for help. Holidays are often a time people attempt to take on too much or do too much on their own. So it's okay to ask for help, Zach. And it's great, like in your case, ask for help. Talk to your brother, your sister, or your mom.
Help me. Help.
Help. Help. And number 10, Zach, again, this is Psychology Today. Linda Walter. Wasn't it Linda Walter? Hold on here. Linda Walter.
She's a fine lady.
Yes. 10 tips for surviving the holidays. Number 10.
Number 10, be good to yourself. If you're feeling blue, pamper yourself. Do what feels good and what you want to do. Try to take a walk or spend time alone if that's what you want. Remember, this is your holiday too.
Okay.
And you can be there for yourself just like you try to be there for everyone else.
Good point.
And that makes sense, because mm-hmm. definitely during the holidays is, you know, people are coming out asking for a Friendsgiving, or you have to go to your mom's house for this, and you have to go to, not from personal experience, but then your girlfriend's or fiance's or wife's or husband's place. And then there's a lot of demands that are going on, and everyone, it's the holidays, so everyone thinks that you just have to do it. Well, if you're feeling down, just go for a walk.
Or you're an adult and you make a decision to say, look, I'm going to do what I think is right, what I want to do versus being pressured. So
exactly. The fear of disappointing somebody and the making a decision based off the thought of not hurting somebody shouldn't be the way about going about making decisions.
And I agree, Zach, for everybody but me. So when it comes to your dad.
You'd be there now.
Yeah, but he said, go here now. Be there at 2 o'clock.
10 a.m. I said 10 a.m. Be there at 9:30. Rawr.
Yeah, exactly. Well, that was 10 ideas from Psychology Today. Linda Walter to survive the holidays. You're listening to WRLR 98.3 FM Info Explorers. Usually it's Ted Schneider and Bob Slipke, but tonight it's Ted Schneider and Zach Schneider. And let's
that's
take
me.
A. I'm sorry.
I said that's me.
That's you. 1 second here.
You're listening to 98.3 WRLR LP, Round Lake, Illinois.
Sorry about that. Hit the button for a second. But again, this is Ted Schneider and Zach Schneider on Info Explorers coming to you live from the Round Lake Beach Metro Station and 2 blocks north of Wrigley. Gosh, the technology is so cool. Well, Zach, you know, we're going to, the last thing I want to talk about since the holidays are coming up. We got 10 regifting rules. That'd be the second article. DaveRamsey.com. See that one? It'd be the second, probably the third page. Excuse me. It's 10 regifting rules by DaveRamsey.com.
I'm there.
All right. Well, number one, you know, a lot of times people regift things. They go, oh, this is so nice, but I'll use it to give to somebody else. Now, I have relatives that have done that. They give you the same gift back. And that's pretty cheesy. So if you're going to re-gift, I think the first thing is you better have a system. If, you know, if Susan gives you a gift, don't give it back to her. You got to put something on it that says, don't give to Susan. Maybe the first thing is I would definitely label things so you know who they came from and when. You know, if it's something from 2007 and now it's 2019, a 12-year-old thing might not be so
now
cool.
This is now it's a gag gift.
Exactly, or a white elephant. So number one. This is, again, 10 regifting rules, DaveRamsey.com. The gift should make sense. You know, while regifting is a great way to save money, cheap, and declutter, minimalist, don't regift something for the sake of regifting. If you didn't like it, there's a chance the new recipient won't like it either. You know, if it's a piece of, you know, just, I wouldn't regift it.
You know what's funny about this is so at my previous job, we had during the holidays, during Christmas, we had a white Santa. We did a gifting, and okay. We all got it. We all went into a conference room, and we didn't know who had who for gifts.
Was it Secret Santa? Secret Santa?
Secret Santa. Secret okay. Santa, yeah, sorry.
White Santa.
Okay, it's got to be a white guy.
Go ahead,
but
sorry.
So, no, it's all good. We were sitting in a conference room, and we all just kind of said, like, you know, highlighters, office utensils, this and that, you know, just kind of giving some cheap, friendly suggestions. So when that person heard what their, you know, their person that had a gift to, that they had an idea. And so it was just this one lady, and she gave off, you know, office supplies, like fun little, you know, thingies, nothing too crazy. And I remember, it was so funny. So the guy that had to gift her, was he was late, running behind, didn't have anything, and he literally gave her one of those, like the Tide bleach pens, and he didn't even wrap it. He just put it in a grocery bag and just put it in like the pot for her to eventually find, and it made things awkward to say the least. So
a Tide Tide bleach or the like the stain stick.
Yeah, one of those stain sticks. If you stain your shirt, you can just run over. And like, it was clearly not a thought-out gift at all. And just a last-minute, like, I have to get something, so this is what you're getting. And she was not happy because everyone else got what they wanted. Everybody else in the room got what they asked for, close to what they asked for. And, yeah, she was not a happy camper, to say the least.
Now, at the end, did you reveal who your Secret Santa was? Or no?
Oh, yeah. Oh, we all knew who did it.
Jerk.
He ended up leaving the company, not because of that. But
well, I think it was. I think, Zach, that's why he left. He was forced out based on a Tide stick.
I should bring up the exiting conversation of why he left, and it might be in there.
Yeah. All right, well, we're talking about 10 regifting rules. This is Ted Schneider and Zach Schneider on WRLR 98.3 FM. Zach, number two.
Number two, here we go. Take off the gift tag. When you decide to regift the scarf your Aunt Susan gave you last year, make sure you take off the old gift tag off the box or bag that came in. Imagine the fun at your Christmas party when your friend Sarah opens up the gift bag addressed to you, signed with love from Aunt Susan. Talk about a re-gifting fail.
Yeah, so in other words, the to and the from you got to take off. I mean, don't be stupid. My goodness. Let's see here.
That would be quite the conversation to have, especially if it's something embarrassing.
Right. Exactly. Or personal, like underwear or something, you know, your aunt.
Yeah. This isn't the right size.
Yeah. And it's women's, not men's. Oops. Don't re-gift gifts you receive from meaningful people. Well, what? If they don't mean anything, that makes no sense. Don't re-gift things that you got from meaningful people. So you're a meaningful person. I can't re-gift it? No, if you're a meaningful person, I think they got something better. Let's see what it says here. Speaking of Aunt Susan, she took time to pick out that scarf, even if it's not your style. And she's so sweet, and you love her so much. Imagine the smile on her face when she sees you sporting that scarf at the next family gathering. Well, maybe Aunt Susan's getting old, and she doesn't remember. I guess what they're saying is if it's something significant from somebody, you might want to at least wear it once. Show Aunt Susan, and then re-gift it the next year. So make sure it's clean.
Or you don't use it at all, just so you don't feel bad, because it was never worn by you then.
That's true. And Aunt Susan goes, oh, where's that scarf? You go, oh, I'm saving it for a special occasion, Aunt Susan. So, yeah, I don't get that one. You know what?
Yeah. I like number four.
Mm-hmm.
So number four is don't re-gift family gifts. This should go without saying, but we're saying it anyway. Don't give family heirlooms away. For example, your mom sentimentally gave you your grandma's ornate last month. You know you won't wear it, but you have a friend who loves vintage items and would adore it. That's fine, but please don't re-gift that brooch. Instead, hit up a thrift store for your friend and keep the brooch in your jewelry box where it belongs. So I'm thinking, like, you do something for Christmas Eve, you get something from grandma, or you get something from a family member, and then it's rewrapped the next morning for Christmas morning to your brother or to your mom, and just re-gifting it instantly the day of. Talk about not preparing for Christmas.
Yeah, and that makes sense. If it's a family heirloom, I mean, you don't want to give away, you know, grandma's prized, you know, brooch or whatever, you know, necklace, because at some point, you know, it might have to be given back because grandma, you know, was getting old and she shouldn't have given it away and she promised it to somebody else. So just an idea. Avoid regifting within the same circle of friends. It's embarrassing. Your friend Jen gave you a perfectly fine set of coffee mugs. Coffee mugs? Oh, yeah, that's what I want. Give me some coffee mugs. Like, I don't have like 19 of them.
That's the gift that's me number one on my list.
Yeah, so I guess the point is if you give the mugs to someone, a close circle of friends, in your close circle of friends, and then you go to their house, and they go, wait a second, those ones I gave you, how'd she get them? So in other words, you know, like Friends, the TV show, they would never re-gift among each other because they'd show up at each other's house and go, wait a second, I gave so-and-so those, how did you get them? So you want to re-gift outside of your circle of friends, people that would never, never see those things. Number six, Zach, again, this is Dave Ramsey's top 10 tips for re-gifting this holiday season.
Alrighty, number six, we are at beware of the re-gift that keeps on giving. If an item has been sitting in your re-gifting closet, which that must be a very interesting closet, for a couple of years, you might not remember where it came from. Assume you're always one re-gift away from giving the gift back to the original giver. Mm-hmm. Re-gifting is okay, which I don't know about that, but when we tell you to give back this holiday season, this isn't what we're talking about, which that would be super embarrassing.
Yes, it would.
Having a gift and you're giving it back to the person who gave it to you. And just imagine that conversation that you'd have to have, like the, oh, this isn't the one that you bought me. Like, we had the same idea, you know, like that'd be so.
Yeah, well, plus, if you have a re-gifting closet, there's something going on. Like, what do you do?
Yeah.
Every gift? Well, that's why I said you get a gift right away. If you're not going to use it, put the date on there and who gave it to you. Boom, right away. Put a post-it note on there, stick something on it, and then at least you know when it was and who it was from.
Well, also, not only that, but who gets a gift from somebody where they're just like, I don't like this, but I'm going to hold on to this because somebody's going to like it.
Yeah, exactly. Well, we're going to run through the last couple. We have about 2 minutes left, Zach. We're just going to run through these things at the end here.
Man, that went fast.
Yeah, give sooner rather than later. Again, you know, if it's a fruitcake, it's going to expire. So again, don't keep things for 20 years and re-gift. Number eight,
re-gift in moderation. Look, if you're following these guidelines, re-gifting here and there is fine. But let's not pretend we're the Oprah Winfrey of re-gifting. You get a re-gift. Everyone gets a re-gift.
Yeah, that's true.
With that strategy, you're bound to re-gift the wrong item and end up hurting someone's feelings. Plus, and it's 2019, so you're always going to hurt someone's feelings no matter what you do.
That's true.
But plus, you could come across as just being plain cheap. Okay. And nobody wants that.
No, exactly. It'd be embarrassing. The last two, rewrap the gift, of course. You know, rewrap it. Make it something better. If it's a shower gift you want to get for Christmas, make sure it's Christmas paper. And lastly, be honest. If you accidentally gifted something, be honest and say, oh, I'm sorry, I've lost my mind. What was I thinking? But in other words, I would re-gift again.
Oh, Janet, you gave this to me? Oh, how did it slip up?
Yeah, but I would re-gift in moderation, just like drinking in moderation, just like everything else in moderation. Well, folks, this is Info Explorers. This is Ted Schneider and Zach Schneider coming to you live from the Round Lake Beach Metro Station on WRLR 98.3 FM. Zach, any closing comments?
Not too much. Just thank you for having me. It's been, I was thinking about it before taking this phone call. The last time I was on your show was actually in person. And man, that was probably 5 to 6 years ago. So it's good to kind of get back into the creative juices. Hopefully all our listeners enjoyed the show tonight. And again, I just appreciate greatly to have this opportunity to do this tonight. It's been fun.
And Zach, anytime. Well, folks, that's all we have time for. Again, Zach Schneider, Ted Schneider, Info Explorers. Catch us next week. Bob will be back from his 2 weeks in Florida. I'm sure they have a few stories about the new Star Wars exhibit. Again, Info Explorers on WRLR 98.3 FM. Zach, thank you very much. Folks, we'll catch you next week.
Thank you.
And I thank you.
the door. Little sister, don't you? Little sister, don't you? Little sister, don't you kiss me once or twice and say it's very nice and then you run. Little sister, don't you do what your big sister does. Every time I see your sister, well, she's got somebody new. She's mean and she's evil like that little old moon evil. Guess I'll try my luck with you. Little sister, don't you? Little sister, don't you? Little sister, don't you kiss me once or twice and say it's very nice and then you run. Little sister, don't you do what your big sister does? Well, I used to pull your pigtails and pinch your turned up nose, but you've been growing and baby, it's been showing from your head down to your toes. Little sister, don't you? Little sister, don't you? Little sister, don't you kiss me once or twice and say it's very nice and then you're wrong. Little sister, don't you?